So our next session today is going to be on Fooled by Smartness. We have two speakers, Mr. Aravind, Unni and Rumi Aijaz. So we know that programs such as the JNN URM, AMRUT and Smart Cities Mission were implemented to transform urban centers using smart solutions. However, we've seen that these have diluted the role of urban local bodies by delegating responsibilities to unelected entities. Unelected entities like private enterprises have been given more power to deliver important critical public services, which has thereby led to the commodification of services. This session today will aim to interrogate the neoliberal nature of today's urban policies that has reduced citizens to mere consumers. The first topic will be on housing and land rights in smart cities by Mr. Aravind Unni. I request Mr. Aravind Unni to come to the stage. So Mr. Aravind Unni is an architect with a BArch from Jamia Millia Islamia and has a master's from Berkeley University of California. He currently is pursuing his PhD on urban social movements from TIS in Mumbai. He works as an urban poverty thematic lead with Indo-Global Social Services and handles developmental interventions with urban poor across 15 states. His core area of interest is on urbanization and its intersection with poverty in cities. He has worked with communities in participatory planning, formulated policy recommendations for people's concerns related to housing and livelihoods, and has advocated for equitable and just cities. Over to you, Mr. Aravind.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks a lot for the very long and nice introduction. Yeah, thank you. My name is Aravind and I'm representing IGSS here, which is acronym for Indo-Global Social Service Society. It's an organization based in Delhi and we are also working on the ground and a grassroots organization, but we also believe in kind of supporting grassroots organizations across different cities. So IGSS works with more than 45 different partners across the country and in 25 different cities. What I will be kind of talking about here, topic is a little challenging because of multiple reasons. Primarily because one is that we have heard so much about smart cities. We have heard every Sunday or every Twitter tweet that goes from Ministry of Housing Urban Affairs is kind of giving you daily different numbers on what smart cities are, how is it playing out, and what are the different kind of projects that are coming out on a day-to-day basis. And here also we might have a different conflicting sort of opinion of whether it's working really well, as some people did say that in Chennai it's rolling out super well and all the projects are underway, we're doing really well, and in some other cities there is nothing that's happening. So I will not take a policy perspective here. I will not take a bird's eye view on the whole issue. But what I'll try and do in this very small little time that I have is to collect whatever little anecdotal instances, stories, narratives that we have or that I kind of got to know because a couple of our partners and friends work in these couple of different cities. And through those, we are kind of trying to understand the bigger narrative and how probably smart cities is actually is fooling us with new terminologies and new numbers every day on a very sort of regular day-to-day basis. So we'll be primarily addressing two smart cities that we have interacted with and we worked with on issues on these two smart cities. Both of them are little different in terms of where they're coming from, what is a smart city proposal, etc. One is the city of Indore, which is very famous or infamous rather in this specific context because of a lot of demolitions that have happened in the past, especially in the last 2-3 years, and because it always is pitched as a very strong model of how a city should develop and should city should function, because all the rankings and all the competition results that the Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs comes out with, Indore is invariably in the first top 10. That could be because of political reasons, but it's inevitably there in the first top 10. Second city that you would be referring, or I would be referring to, is NDMC, which is the core of Delhi, if you've been to Delhi, which is the Latin's Delhi, the most prosperous and the most resourceful in terms of the resources that it has, and that's the other smart city that I'd be referring to. And again, like I said, it's going to be a bottom-up perspective and not a top-down, because there are already multiple studies that are there on top-down, big narrative studies on smart cities. So this is, I'm not getting into what smart cities are, the pan-city and area-based development. I'm straight away taking you to this area-based development proposal that's there for Indore. These documents are available there on the internet, but then again, to go through 900 pages of content and to kind of narrow down to these specific plans, wherever they have been put out in case of Indore, they have. And this is the area-based development plan for Indore, old city, old part of the city. And as you can see, they have marked the slums around the city or around the old city in green. And the blue part is the core old city which they want to pedestrianize, and that's how the whole area-based proposal looks like. Next image, please. What you see here very clearly is that Indore has, if you compare the both images, very clearly all the slum pockets or informal settlement pockets, as you call it, they have been picked and all those areas have been made into green spaces. A lot of developments that they were not able to do in the past, like for instance, a lot of the roads, new roads that have come up cutting through settlements were from the old DP roads but could not be implemented because most of our development plans are not implemented. But they have been carried forth in the area-based development for Indore under smart cities, and they have been shown to cut through the whole old settlement. And it is these streets that will provide for, as they claim, for BRT, for cycle lanes, etc., etc. Next image, please. So Indore, very smartly, what it has done is that it calls it for a sustainable, open, greener Indore in the future. What they've done is that they've used their old existing plans that they could not implement. They have used smart cities as a scheme to very clearly identify, mark settlements that were, you know, right in the center of the city and have been playing a huge role in the running of the city and has had a huge cultural connection to how the whole city functioned. They have earmarked that, and very smartly through kind of referring to different projects that have not probably worked that well, for instance the Sabarmati Riverfront, that has been kind of transported from Ahmedabad to the city of Indore. Whether it works well on the ground, not working on the ground, that doesn't matter, because the image itself is quite alluring, and they have actually sold this image, and this is how the smart city proposal looks. The first section on the left is actually saying of how 1.14% of land which is there open now would become 10.32, and they are not telling you the story of how that will happen. Is that for a greener greener sustainable future, you are actually picking up more than 6,000 households and putting them and transporting, or at least proposing to transport them to the ghettos that Dr. Karen was talking before this. Next image. So in the smart city proposal, very clearly what you see is is a sort of vilification of the urban poor, urban working poor. And what it does is that it kind of refers to slums and informal settlements, not in the nice words that smart city proposals otherwise carry, but in the words like that every third resident is a slum dweller, and this is a threat to the development of Indore as a smart city. Slums and the kind of population that they kind of cover, they also kind of damage the general visage of the city. So this is the language and the criminal sort of labeling that goes around smart city and smart city plans. Next image, please. And what this has done was, even before the making of the plans, the ideas that were incorporated from the CDPs, from the development plans, could give way to demolitions or evictions like this. Shekhar Nagar was considered to be the mother, or you could call it the father of all slums. But what Dharavi is to Bombay was CP Shekhar Nagar to kind of Indore. To just kind of give you the context, it was said that all the working class movements, all the other slum settlements or informal settlement pockets that have come out in the city, have come out from this city. So it was a message that CP Shekhar Nagar, which has been there for the last 50 years, housing more than 700-600 households, with legal land holding, a good chunk of 50 or 60% of those 700 households had legal land tenures under the MP Patta Act. They would not be tolerated in the city because the smart city is coming, and this is not how we want our city to be. So that, I think, was a big departure from the earlier plans that could not be implemented due to what various reasons. But the smart city could ensure that a settlement like CP Shekhar Nagar could be taken away from the center of the city. Next image, please. What it led to is this. And what is there on the projects is what they say is riverfront development and redevelopment of public land. This is how it sounds. This is how it sounds on the paper. But what it gives you in return is this. They achieve two objectives with that. Is that Indore Municipal Corporation already kind of possessed, I think, 15,000 houses from the last schemes that no one was willing to take in the first place, which is very similar to what has happened in Perumbakkam, which is very similar to what has happened in Bombay in the case of Mahul, where you had a surplus. Huge bunch of settlements that were created from the last schemes where no one was willing to relocate. But seeing that there is an opportunity that we can actually clear off a lot of informal settlements and put them there, we kind of tick two objectives. One is that yes, our smart city riverfront development is happening. Second, so many people have gotten houses under PMAY. So that is how this whole operation happened. Next slide, please. Why this was even more problematic or kind of reveals the true identity of how smart cities function is that this did not even stop there. The roads that were cutting through settlements actually cut through middle class neighborhoods, which does not usually happen, but happened in Indore. And these evictions were normalized, saying that this is our heritage part of town. Indore will be the most, it's already the economic capital of central India, or at least Madhya Pradesh definitely, but it will be the cultural sort of capital of our state, and hence we have to bear with it. So around 70 odd different roads were supposed to be widened, and around 10,000 households and shopkeepers were to be affected by this. This has not completely happened due to a lot of legal hurdles, but a substantial chunk has already happened, and this is what it has led to. Next image, please. What makes it further more complicated is that that all the smart cities are supposed to make proposals and are supposed to go through this whole competitive business, and they're supposed to ask for money. There is only a reserved sum that comes from the state and the center. The rest they are supposed to generate by themselves. So what Indore has done, it's more of a exception actually, where the funds that they are seeking is around to the tune of 5,000 crores, which by the standard of a city like Indore is way higher, and what the center and the state give is only 1,000 crores. So Indore has become this sort of city that is pitched that they require so much of money, and right now what they're doing is that they're looking very actively, as opposed to probably schemes before this. I think Vinay, who's studied JNURM really well, would probably be able to kind of tell us more on that, is that cities are now having access to loans, are having access to wanting to access more amount of money so that they can actually execute the projects which are mostly infrastructure-led developments and not for social social sector developments, which are for, let's say, housing for the economically weaker sections and so forth. So Indore has actually kind of given us a new way of working with the smart city model and generate that amount of money to actually do a lot of projects, and they are trying to do that right now. Next image. Compared to this, there is this other image of the NDMC smart city, which is a very sort of benign model of the smart city model. They're not seeking much funds because they are almost mostly developed. But again, they have put up these little vending, their toilets have been transformed into a place where you have water vending possibility. One glass costs 1 rupees. And the bottle, if you get it filled, costs 5 rupees. They have 100-odd such vending machines and toilets spread across the NDMC area, which is the Lutyens part of Delhi. But point to note here is that why is they are saying that we will propagate and improve our walking facilities? All these facilities have come up on pavements that are there because the pavements there are wide. Next image, please. Usually or mostly, NDMC has stuck to very, again, benign forms of adding water kiosk, adding kiosk for filing FIRs, and all those ICT-related developments, which are not, out in the face as leading to evictions or other forms of displacement. Next image. Next image, beautification and these things are always a part of the whole discourse. But what NDMC very smartly does and what other cities probably don't do, I don't know why have they selected these global benchmarks, because according to benchmarks, NDMC is probably the most developed or the global, almost the global city that we can aspire to. But I think the benchmarks are very interesting to look at and how they connect or not connect to what is the reality on the ground. Next image, please. These are the cities that they've referred to. And frankly, some of the cities, I didn't even have an idea of why they were talking about Makati and a lot of other cities. But probably some of them were thinking that if we put our names in these proposals, we might get exposure trip to go to these cities or something like that. Maybe. We don't know. But anyways, all these names have come there in the NDMC proposal, and the most shocking ones were the fact that percentage of city population living in slums, they have said 0%, and we would be similar to Helsinki. The other one is even more shocking, is for every 1 lakh population, we will only have 5.89 homeless people, which is a Dubai standard. So what is really shocking is that there are 6,000 or 8,000 around households in informal settlements and slums in NDMC area right now. There are more than 5,000 homeless according to unofficial estimates, and NDMC has not really been willing over the last 3-4 years to make simple homeless shelters, not even houses for the homeless there. And by putting up these statistics and saying that we will achieve them by 2030, means only one thing, is that you pick them up and you put them outside the NDMC boundaries, which is not much, which is just a 6 square kilometer patch in the center of the city. But it is these standards that are being kind of used in kind of making our smart city proposals, which is quite appalling as a fact. Next image, please. So what NDMC does, as opposed to Shekhar Nagar demolition, where the Indore Municipal Corporation was very proactive in actually doing the demolition and making those plans, NDMC gets on this whole spree of demolishing slum hutments, informal hutments, and clearing of homeless and other people who they want cleared through the smart city plans. Next image. This is a very good example of how ideas circulate. So one very first example of how flyovers and spaces under flyovers were utilized for beautification was very one good example was in Matunga, where resident welfare associations along with the local BMC Municipal Corporation beautified a flyover under Matunga, and that same idea was incorporated and taken over by different bodies, and all across Delhi, including NDMC area, they have started to beautify these spaces, which also mean that a lot of shelters that were made for the homeless, a lot of these population groups that don't otherwise find a space in the city but are working on, let's say, the pavements, as vendors, as sort of different formal worker groups, they were staying there, occupying those spaces, not necessarily in the most right conditions, but they were there. But these designs that were kind of transported from one city to the other, copied from one city to the other, has led to this and being part of the smart city program. Next image, please. Street vendors also, ironically, to the proposal that says that dedicated pedestrian walkways for free from hawkers, and this has all come out after the street vending act has been made into it's a law. They're supposed to follow this, and all this is coming into the NDMC smart city proposals that are going and getting government money. So and that again has led to a spate of evictions and demolition of street vendors. They are either removed, saying that they have they need more space for parking, or second, there is a lot of pressure from. Next image, please. Next image. So a few ideas from these different sort of anecdotal evidences and issues that we have faced on the ground in both NDMC and Indore is that that there is a clear doublespeak where the language of all the smart city proposals is very similar to what we probably have in this audience, that just do a word count of how many times sustainability, of how many times inclusion, of how many times ecological development is used, we will be actually baffled, because the number has gone up considerably. But in terms of idea, in terms of how the projects are conceived and how the projects are manifested, we, like Dr. Amita Bhide was saying, that we need to understand how these projects are going to kind of pan out in the real realm. Very clearly, many studies have already pointed out that there's a huge void in terms of human rights and housing rights based approach. All that it talks about land rights is in the form of housing rights, and that too affordable housing, but we don't know affordable for whom, where will be those houses located. There are no clear benchmarks on that side, and there's a hangover from the last schemes where you are calling slum dwellers or so-called slum dwellers as criminal elements, as a burden on the city, threat, and we are again talking about slum-free cities also in those smart city plans. Next image. Very clearly, smart cities is cherry-picking the policies that they want to work with versus the other progressive policies that exist on the ground. PMAY, Amrit, Smart City are all like one very nicely gelling unit, whereas other schemes which are relatively progressive and have something in store for the population groups that we are working with, like NULM, SUH, Street Vendors Act, a lot of existing policies in the form of local housing slum acts are progressive, and a lot of there is actually more scope of securing land rights in that versus the smart cities. But what Smart City program does is that it only looks at how can our projects be implemented faster, how can we kind of generate more funds, and it's very conveniently selecting the framework that it wants to go with, leaving the others that it doesn't want to go with. Next image, please. There are no benchmarks for this. There's a huge ambiguous space of what actually smart cities mean, who are they meant for, what are they supposed to do, where are the houses supposed to be, what are the benchmarks, standards, that the bare minimums, like the least common denominator that we're talking about in the morning, what are those least common denominators that are required, and whatever. In hindsight, there has been a lot of debate on livability index and etc. But all who have gone to Bombay and knows that Bombay has gotten third spot in the livability index know that there is some problem in framing the whole livability index for the ministry. Next image, please. There is a very clear need for priorities of where are we putting the money on smart cities. More than 2 lakh crore is going to be invested in only, let's say, 2-3% of the urban areas of the cities that we're talking about, benefiting only 8% of the population, mostly. So, is this investment justified, is one of the questions. Next. And again, similar to JNURM, most of the focus is actually only on solid waste management, on roads, infrastructure, on housing, but even within housing, mostly real estate development. So there's a very clear need to kind of understand and break down the proposals, understand where are they getting implemented, who's benefiting out of it, and that can only happen on a very one-on-one engagement on the ground. Next image. It has brought about innovative ideas, not necessarily in the most positive sense. Couple of them that I've already kind of mentioned is that they see that smart city is actually a process where we can get to do a lot of things, because anything that you say is smart kind of sells with the state, the people. It's more easier to evict and demolish. So a lot of innovations have happened on that front. I'll just take one more minute. So now smart cities actually are supporting more than 60 or more riverfront developments. From one city or 2-3 cities in Gujarat, that model has been picked up across projects, and could be because a lot of consultants and consultancies are actually doing multiple projects and doing this. But actually wrong practices are being picked up and scaled at a level that we don't know is going to result in what. So one is that, and different forms of eviction. Smart cities, more than how much of projects have been implemented on the ground, I can tell of different ways of evictions and different reasons based on reasons on which evictions have happened. If you don't have toilets, you are getting evicted because you're not getting the first ranking in the serviction. If you are a street vendor, you're getting evicted because street vendors on the street does not give you ranking 1 in Swachh Bharat serviction. If you are a street vendor in CP and you are burning something, I mean, not burning, cooking food for the vending businesses, they say that you are polluting in Delhi, which is a little shocking. You are polluting the environment, and NGT has put a ban on that. There was a bomb blast that had happened in 96 in different parts of the city, and if you are a street vendor vending there now, that clause is being invoked to say that you cannot even vend there. So, wrong practices are getting replicated, wrong innovative ideas are being done, and cities, especially smaller ones, they see this as an opportunity, this as their Commonwealth game to do the projects that they wanted to do and could not in the past, to get the consultants and experts to make the jazzy plans that look good and sound good, but what they entail and what they carry is completely different. Next image, please. I think that's about it. But few probably lines that I would want to probably add is to kind of go beyond the veneer of smart cities to look at things on the ground. I think it's something that we as an organization and as a network are trying to do, and would probably be wanting everyone else to kind of collaborate in this. And I will use this forum to kind of call on everyone to do that. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Aravind Unni, for taking us through the area-based development proposal of Indore and explaining to us examples at NDMC, and also explaining how the design of these proposals have adverse implications. Our next speaker for this session is Dr. Rumi Aijaz. Dr. Rumi Aijaz is a senior fellow from ORF and leads the Urban Policy Research Initiative. He conceived and designed this program in 2007 and has directed his efforts to study the functioning of institutions at local, state and national level. He has carried out collaborative studies and published many papers on urbanization, urban governance and social development. I request Dr. Rumi to take over.
Thanks for the introduction. Good afternoon, everyone. With the Observer Research Foundation, as has just been said, ORF is basically operates as a public policy think tank and offers advice to the different Indian government ministries or offers policy inputs of the different policies that the ministries are coming out with. Basically, the aim is to aid the policy making process. ORF works closely with the Ministry of External Affairs. They help the ministry in organizing the Raisina Dialogue, which is now held every year. And also, ORF is the key partner of the ministry in the carrying forward the initiatives under the BRICS program of the Government of India. A lot of information has been covered today, so very little is left for me to say, but I have a few thoughts on this subject. As you know very well, a lot of poor people live in Indian cities. They are basically migrants who have come in search of employment. Despite their low education and skills, they are able to find some kind of a job in cities because cities offer numerous opportunities. They are coming from rural areas because the rural areas are unattractive for them. They do not fulfill their aspirations. They are unsustainable in several ways, and therefore there is this demographic shift that is taking place. It can be said that the urban poor are playing an important role in building and running cities. They are in the construction sector. They do a lot of construction work, building of roads and flyovers and malls and other complexes, housing, etc. They're also providing a variety of services to those who live in planned colonies and also who work in different planned areas. But their living conditions and livelihood are matters of great concern, and in this respect they need a lot of support. This support is to be provided by the different ministries of at the national level, by the state and local government departments, and they are doing this work. Numerous policies, laws, programs are designed for them. Funds are allocated, and beneficiaries are identified on which different kinds of projects are applied. But the impact of many of these schemes, one more thing, when schemes are launched, it is said that these are pro-poor and inclusive in orientation, and these are for the good of those persons who are below the poverty line. But we know very well, and as has been brought out today, that most of these welfare schemes have been able to have a very insignificant or marginal effect on the lives of the urban poor. And it is for this reason that a lot of non-governmental organizations, activists, and private organizations, they are coming forward and they are trying to help this segment of the population in a variety of ways. A few examples that I would like to share with you, although some of the examples have already been mentioned, so I will be very brief. The first is the Smart Cities Mission. It's basically it has a lot of technical inputs into it. It was started in the U.S. On the advice of the Clinton Foundation, and who had asked IBM to come up with better cities. So they are a tech company. And Cisco also played a key role at that time. Both companies, they started coming, developing concepts of what a smart city is and how technology can be used in improving the lives of the people. So in so far as the Indian case is concerned, the idea was to create better cities, improve the quality of life and strengthen the economy. But the manner in which it took about 1 year to do all the preparations under the Smart Cities Mission. Smart city plans were designed, prepared, different committees were identified, SPV and PMUs were put in place. But the manner in which this idea is moving forward also creates some amount of concern. Although I feel that it's a very good, sensible idea, because we should not, there is no uniform definition given in India or elsewhere, they are all working towards it, but it offers scope to bring in many dimensions. It all depends upon a person's knowledge and understanding as to what his understanding about smartness is. One can talk about inclusion there, one can talk about conservation of valuable resources. The way in which it is unfolding in India and the emphasis being given to certain aspects is worrying. In the case of NDMC, which my previous speaker just mentioned, I was trying to identify which is the area which has been selected in Delhi. So it is the New Delhi Municipal Council area, which comprises 2% of the population and about 2% of the population of the city. The rest is under the Municipal Corporation of Delhi and the Cantonment Board. So even within that NDMC area, there are some slums. But I learned through some information that's available on the NDMC website that slums have not been included within those limits of the smart city, and therefore all the projects that are being implemented now are for NDMC areas, and there is no impact of those, not any significant impact of those on the slum population. You saw examples of smart street lights and the common public facility center. Elsewhere in different parts of the country, under the mission, common command and control centers are being developed for the swift movement of vehicles. This is also a foreign concept. I saw in Moscow that they have a giant room in which hundreds of data entry operators are sitting, and there are giant screens. They can monitor each and every part of the city because cameras are installed everywhere. And therefore, they take decisions and they pass on the information that's generated to the motorists for swift movement of vehicles. So inclusion in the real sense is not being achieved under the Smart City Mission as far as Delhi is concerned. My second example, next to the Smart Cities Mission, after the Smart Cities Mission, is the housing sector. A lot of speakers have already mentioned. I've personally visited some sites in Ahmedabad where the slum population has been relocated from the Sabarmati river area because of the river face development work. I visited the areas where they were shifted, and the housing, 3 or 4 story housing, has been created for the slum dwellers. But the manner in which this entire exercise has been carried out could have been done more in a much better way. Though good houses have been created, but the conditions there are deteriorating. The location is quite far from the city center, so it has had an impact on the livelihood of those persons, because the places are not very well connected with public transport facilities. One would have to walk to about 2 kilometers to take the city bus service. Also, a related problem was faced by women and girls, because factories are located close by, and therefore they are scared of moving, going out during odd hours because of poor lighting, etc. My third example is about the food security component. Aadhaar has come into being, and it is meant as a tool to empower the poorest of the poor. So a lot of the poor do have an Aadhaar card, but when they go to the food fair price shop or the ration shop, a biometric authentication is required, which for getting a subsidy on different food grains. So many a times, and I too, we also have experience, when you go for your mobile connection or anything else, if you press your finger on that POS point of sale machine, then there is many a times the fingerprints cannot be registered properly. And also, at times they say that the internet connection is not working properly. So when the poor people go there for Aadhaar biometric authentication, then such problems occur, which causes a lot of hardship to such population. My fourth example is final one is of the Nai Manzil scheme, which is a scheme introduced by the Ministry of Minority Affairs. It was introduced in the year 2015. Nai Manzil can be translated in English as, I think, new destination. It's meant for the minorities, and that too for the younger generation between 17 and 35 years of age. It's an integrated education and livelihood program, wherein the World Bank has given 50% of the funding towards the scheme, and the remaining contribution is being made by the Ministry of Minority Affairs. Ministry is working closely with key stakeholders such as Indira Gandhi National Open University, National Institute of Open Schooling, and several other skilling ministry to provide that population which is in the age group of 17 to 35 years free schooling, especially to those who have dropped out or who have studied in informal educational institutions such as the madrasas. So what they do is IGNU has designed the course curriculum, and the National Institute of Open Schooling provides books and other material. So some hours of education is imparted to that group. The skilling agencies are responsible for contacting this group and offering training into the different skills that would be needed in today's times. So it's an integrated program. At the moment the child gets a certificate of schooling at the 10th or 12th level, then they are connected with the skilling program. They get training so that they are able to get some job, either through self-employment or through a proper placement. These are some of the initiatives. My concern, I study urban governance, I've been studying this for long. My point here is, in this, in the context of this today's seminar, is that there are several things that are going on. I feel that all of this can be done in a better manner. It's necessary to understand that the efforts that are being made at different levels, either the national, state or local level, why is it that there is a failure? Do the agencies who are responsible for bringing about this transformation, are they not in a position to do the work? Would this require more strengthening of these institutions? Are they not capable to do it, and why? And whether the right conditions have been created for them to do the work are all matters that one needs to look into if the change has to be brought about. If our vision is to ensure that everybody has a right to the city, and that the people who are in the lower income group or who are poor, if their percentage is brought down like in Europe and in other parts, advanced nations of the world, then some kind of upliftment of the society is needed. You cannot expect the population as it is today to respond to what the government is trying to do or say, because they are not in a position to respond. Therefore, a holistic change is required, and if that is not done, such problems are likely to continue in the years to come. Thank you very much. The lights are too bright, so I face some difficulty in speaking. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Rumi, for sharing some of your insights on Smart City's mission. I request both the speakers to please be seated. We will open this time for questions.
My name is Swarnalata. I'm a freelance volunteer for environmental issues. This is for Aravind. Aren't there going to be any midterm checks and balances for the Smart Cities mission? When does the CAG come into the picture?
All the sessions up until now seem to have led to this session. It takes me back to a book I read. The lunatics are running the asylum, it said. I heard a remark which disturbed me. Can you just clarify that the people don't understand, they're good enough to vote, but they don't understand the policies of the government? Did the speaker mention that, or did I misunderstand it? Yeah, did I misunderstand that? Can you please clarify that point? Yeah, I mean, on why they need to be moved out of the city. You said something that I might have misunderstood. I would like to understand it better, please.
In the public sphere or public domain, when we speak, what do you think about smart cities? Just because it's smart cities, no? And it comes with all this jargon of inclusivity, sustainability, blah, blah, blah. A good section of the youth, just because it comes with these catchy phrases, they think it's very cool. It just sounds very cool, you know. So, firstly, and then if you look at how a lot of the projects are being sold. For instance, I know that Connaught Place, which is center of NDMC, which is the center of this whole Smart City initiative, has Wi-Fi enabled spots. The post that you saw in pictures will give you exact temperature and pollution control. I don't know whether these are the most relevant things that are relevant to the youth in the first place and also to the city in general. I'm sure Jio provides free internet and connections for God knows how many years, and it's very cheap. I don't know where it's come from, but I'm again saying that wireless technology and all these free Wi-Fis is something that at least the smart city imagines will connect with the youth, and probably to some extent it does, we don't know, but at least the fact that beyond these nice phrases and the way they are putting it, there are actual issues that have to be addressed, there is a real need for furthering engagement. I think that is where the youth have to probably come in, because everyone will you know, I mean, you are the next generation citizens who are going to lead the country. So I think that is very important. My second comment to Swanalta is that what are the checks and balances, frankly, with the projects that my little interaction with, let's say, smart cities and PMAY, for instance, it's very tough to interact with these schemes. Though they sound transparent and though you have most of the documents uploaded on the website, to cut through that, to understand how the linking of these schemes happen. You know, I mean, there was a very nice discussion where Shweta was pointing about the coastal road, and Dr. Amita was connecting of how the coastal road links up, and there's a huge ring that is planned now of how these smart city proposals are broken into projects and how those projects connect on the ground. If you, every city will have 100-150 projects, so how many can you watch, how many can you kind of keep an eye on? We don't know, but the only check and balance should be is that everything comes on public domain, which it does not. Even if it comes in a crypted form of 150 pages multiplied by 3, because annexure, proposal, and so there is a responsibility that we have as citizens, as people in that city, to understand, to engage, to break it down, to make it simple. I think those are probably our responsibilities, but I don't know where does CAG come in. Maybe it should come in, because look at the projects that are going in the smart city. Against the existing norms and guidelines for solid waste management, for instance, they are proposing energy to waste plants in NDMC area, and those plants are going to be run by a lot of firms like ILFS, which is going to be it's already taken over, I think. So there is clear give and take probably happening, but we don't know. So where does CAG come in? With my little knowledge, I can't say, but it should probably come in somewhere, and it should start with our interaction with these projects on one-to-one basis and our awareness in the first place. Yeah.
Maybe I said something and it got understood in a different way.
So can you just say that again, what you said?
What was the point?
You said that people like that, when you spoke about the poor, you said they may not understand the issues of the city, and that's one reason they have to be relocated. About governmental policy and things like that, which was not the way I understand people.
Yeah, I gave the example of Ahmedabad, where there was some relocation that took place, and it had an impact on the livelihood of those communities, because they were very connected to the city center. And unless you do relocation in a complete manner, you have to do the complete work and planning. You do incomplete things, and it is bound to have an impact on different age groups that belong to that community. So that was my point, that if you do relocation, okay, but you do it, you should have a complete plan, and that plan, there are, you know, the difference between advanced nations and our side of the world is that they have taken care of the basic things, and they are trying to offer a superior quality of life in many respects. Unfortunately, here in many emerging economies, as you put it, there is a lot of work that has been done on paper, policies, laws, plans, programs, projects, etc. But the implementation on the ground is lacking. I go further to say that one needs to understand whether the right conditions have been created for the government functionaries to implement that plan. You come out with unreasonable things, and then you ask the functionaries to implement. They are not in a position to do that. So you prepare them for their task. And here I am referring to capacity building, strengthening, before even devolution of funds, functionaries, etc. to local government units. So we are expecting a lot of things an action from the government, but we are not trying to understand that those who are trying to govern are in a position to do or not.
Thank you, Dr. Rumi. Thank you, Mr. Aravind. We will now take a short tea break.